Hello. In the last lesson, we talked about the decline of parallel cinema, the changes that were made in the Hindi cinema in the 70s, and the transformation of parallel cinema as we know it today. In today's lecture, we'll talk about the changes in Indian economy post-liberalization. We study the impact of liberalization, particularly on Indian cinema and Hindi cinema, and study the rise of NRI films and filmmakers. Now let's start with liberalization. So what do you understand by liberalization? Well, for those of you who are too young to know, in the 1980s, state-owned enterprises were controlling the Indian economy in general. There were very few private players. They were of course Tata's, Reliance, and these companies were there, but they were not of that stature as we know them today. They were generally state-owned enterprises. You have government controlling these enterprises, and they used to basically create goods that were consumed by the Indian market. Outside imported goods were not allowed or were very highly priced and very few people could afford them. And what happened was, because of general mismanagement, these state owned enterprises, because they had no competition and they had no thing for competition, because they were monopolies in general, they started to fail to generate profits. Now, because they were government owned, so government used to lend them money. So then government had to bail these enterprises out, and this led to less money for the government to do the developmental projects, to fund developmental projects, and it increased budget deficits. So slowly and slowly the coffers of Indian economy started to deplete, and by the 1990, the economic condition of India was at its lowest point. And at this time, something dramatic happened in Middle East. Iraq invaded Kuwait, which actually affected in two ways. Firstly, because of the invasion, Kuwait being a Middle Eastern country, Iraq being a Middle Eastern country, and many Indians working in the Middle East, the money that used to come through remittances from the Middle East started to deplete. So another source of foreign income took a hit for the government. And the second was, of course, because of the rising oil prices, and because India used to import all its oil needs, the budget deficit increased further, because government used to subsidize that oil. It didn't sell it at market price, it used to subsidize oil. So the pressure on the government became very intense, and India was at the edge to default, which is known as a sovereign default, which is a very big deal for a country. Once a country defaults, it becomes very problematic to get any sort of funding or any sort of money from the outside world. Now, to avoid defaulting, in 1991, India took two loans from IMF, which is the International Monetary Fund. In return, IMF asked India to introduce certain reforms. So India basically deregulated the markets, devalued its currency, and of course reduced the import restrictions and tariffs. Now, to deregulate the market, it dismantled many state-owned enterprise, it devalued its currency, rupee dropped in respect to dollar, and import of goods became easier as the taxes on imported stuff and the restrictions on imported stuff started to decline. This basic deregulation and opening up of Indian economy is actually known as liberalization of Indian economy, which began in 1991. Now, with liberalization came cable and satellite television. Now, before this liberalization, by 1985, television had become a significant part of Indian society, especially in the urban centers, metros like Chennai, Kolkata, Mumbai, Delhi. These urban centers, television had become a part of daily life. Now, but the television was restricted to one channel, which is Doordarshan only. Now, by 1991, after liberalization, saw the emergence of cable networks. So your first television sets like Star TV, BBC, CNN became into the Indian households, especially in the urban centers. And by 1992, first Hindi channel called ZTV, private Hindi channel, came into existence. Now, TV was a fresh medium. So people who had not seen TV before, or now we were able to buy TV, since TV was another restricted item that you had to get a license to purchase, became freely available. So more people could buy them. So a population or people watching TV increased. And so the entertainment, which had been restricted to cinema halls, suddenly came into the drawing room. So more and more people started staying indoors for that, receiving that entertainment from these different channels. And very soon, India, because of its growing market and its growing liberalization, ad revenue also started pouring into television. And as the popularity grew, more ad revenue came, more the TV grew. And so soon, cable networks had 50 and 100 channels in different languages, regional languages. There were a rise of Tamil channel, Malayalam channel, Kannada channel, Bengali channels, Hindi channels. So a growth in the television industry started to happen. As this television industry was growing, film industry perceived TV as a threat. It is reminiscent of what Hollywood felt in 1950s when the television had come in the West, especially in the US. So at that time, Hollywood also perceived television as a threat, and in 1990s, Indian film industry also perceived television as a threat for the entertainment quotient of Indian population. However, over time, this mutual animosity became lessened and they started developing a mutually beneficial relationship. They started taking each other's backs, looking after each other. Now, television channels have become a fresh platform for films. Why? Because today's film industry, if you look at it, utilizes television networks for promotion and marketing purpose. Look at the different reality shows. You have guests who come to these reality shows who are film stars and they promote their new films. So they are promoting films on television networks, or television networks showcase the coming trailers. They showcase, they talk about the films in production. So there is a marketing and promotion atmosphere that has been created between television and film. And of course, movies, film award shows, songs have become a very good source of revenue for television network. So every television network hosts either a film award show or showcases films, and of course, many music show film music. So they instead of having competition, they started having a more symbiotic relationship. But that doesn't mean that they were never in competition. They are still in competition. TV networks and film industry both vie for audience attention. So what happened was, films started facing competition, and this competition came from the daily soaps and the game shows on television. Reality TV, which is basically the most recent television invention, basically has captured the imagination of audience. Just look at, scroll through your history. If you have a set-top box, you will know that if you go through the various channels and you will see how many reality shows are coming these days on different channels, and you will get to sense how big reality TV has become. Now, audience, the film industry could no longer take audience for granted. If you look at the 80s cinema, if you look at early 90s cinema, you will find that it lacked the substantialness that was there in the 70s. It is very superficial. It doesn't talk about anything that is thought provoking. Like in the 70s, you had a disillusionment. You had the character of an angry young man who was rebelling against the society. But in the 80s and the early 90s, that had come down. You had certain social films which were about society, about relationships, but most in general, the mainstream film industry had taken a nosedive in the quality of content. If you look at it in the 70s and 60s, the type of songs that were there and the quality of the cinema that was there in 60s and 70s, and the cinema that was present in the 80s and the early part of 90s, there's a huge gap. This gap was because of that. So, but with the advent of television, filmmakers had to constantly come up with fresh and innovative ideas just to get the audiences off the drawing room and into the cinema halls where they could get the maximum amount of money. So, this became a win-win situation for the audience, because now they had greater variety, not in the drawing room as well as in the cinema hall. This created a sort of a boom for the film industry because of its innovative and more technologically invented and new ideas. They started capturing global audiences. Now, liberalization also led to internationalization of film production and distribution. Why? Because of the taxes and tariffs being lowered, Indian cinema, which has always been popular in the Middle Eastern countries because of the diaspora present there, Eastern Europe and Central Asian countries because of the close relationship India had with the then Soviet Union, and the types of films, Raj Kapoor's Awara, Shri 420, were very popular in the Soviet Union because they had similar socialistic values attached to them. So, internationally, Indian films had always been popular, but now Indian films and filmmakers started receiving critical acclaim on global platform, because once you started innovating, you started bringing new ideas, you started getting attention on a global platform on the Western countries where Indian cinema had not yet made a dent. So Indian films started appearing in major film festivals like Cannes, Venice, and they had started creating a new buzz around them. Also, this means that when you come in Cannes and Venice film festivals, then you get Western media landscape attention, which means that you get Western media coverage. And once you get Western media coverage, people in the West started knowing that there are something called Indian films also. So a new market was being created. And in this scenario came the NRIs and Indian films. NRIs is short for non-resident Indians. So basically they are part of the Indian diaspora which is living abroad. Now, the effect of liberalization was that overseas market opened up for Indian film. So now Indian films could be marketed in places like Europe and North America, where you had a very large presence of NRIs, many Indians having traveled for jobs and were living in these countries, and these NRIs had a big nostalgic attachment to India and Indian films. So Indian filmmakers knew that there is a market there, there is a sizable population to which they can make films for and sell those films so as to get money, because they had more purchasing power than the Indians themselves. So the distribution services of Indian films started opening up in America and Europe. These countries became, and they are still, profitable for Indian filmmakers, so much so that Indian filmmakers started making movies only for the NRI audience, and they actually started to negate the domestic audience, and this led to a new genre of in Indian cinema called family entertainers, which meant that these were love stories with elaborate songs, many songs and dance routine, and revolved around the family. They showcased wealth and prosperity, and these films were cultural spectacles. Now, wealth and prosperity in India, you know that there is a lot of poverty, there is a lot of hardships, but the cinema that filmmakers were creating were filled with wealth and prosperity, and this was because they were projected towards the NRI, who are more well off than an average Indian is. So it was for their consumption, not for the domestic consumption, and so in 1990s, suddenly you see heroes and heroines, even in family entertainers. Just look at the size of the families and the wealth that is projected in those families. You have expensive necklaces, you have huge palatial homes, you have a Gaudian way of depicting wealth, and which is very different to a normal Indian household. So in the 70s and 80s, you had the villains that had such kind of wealth, and the hero was basically from a poor background and from a not that rich a background. But now you had the main protagonist only from a wealthy, prosperous background. So Indian press, because of this, became very critical for films and their filmmakers, because they were like, you are only pandering to the homesickness of an NRI and you are ignoring the domestic audience. And the diaspora audience, they were getting the same type of family entertainers. These NRI films had, you know, sacrificing love, family over love. So you have your Hum Aapke Hain Kaun, Hum Saath Saath Hai, all of these films were very family oriented, and they were actually the celebration of Indian values, so called Indian values. Now, Indian cinema started in the 1990s developing a very conservative outlook. If you look at few parallel cinema of the 70s, or the cinema, a few notable names like Mirch Masala of the 80s, Smita Patil star of films, or Jaane Bhi Do Yaaro of the 80s, there was a sense of, you know, a sense of liberalization. But because of this so-called Indian value films or family entertainers, in the 1990s, a very conservative outlook developed. So even though it was set in modern times, narrative became very traditionalist. Like, love is not a rebellion. You have to sacrifice love for the sake of the family. Whereas before that, throughout the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, you had a cinema where people used to rebel love and rebel against their families. But now families become, because they were depicting NRIs who had this sort of a nostalgic, we have talked about nostalgia and modernism, but a nostalgic sense, a romanticism towards the Indian culture, because they were living away from it. So they as they say, grass is greener on the out, on the other side. So they were nostalgic about their India, and their India, it was very traditionalist, it was very strict and patriarchal. So this specific image of Indian tradition was what the global audience got. So films like Dilwale Dulhaniya Le Jayenge, Pardes, Yaade, Kuch Kuch Hota Hai, Taal, Kaho Na Pyar Hai, all of these films are symbolism of that NRI mindset and the making of the NRI culture in India. So filmmakers like Subhash Ghai, Karan Johar, Aditya Chopra made their bread and butter on such films. So here are the posters of such films, Hum Saath Saath Hai, Dilwale Dulhaniya Le Jayenge, Pardes. So all of these films are about NRIs, for NRIs, or they talk about Indian values. So now let's come to the NRI filmmakers. Now NRIs also started producing and directing film. Because of liberalization, you had the option where foreign funding could come into films. So that meant that NRIs could now get their money, which they had a lot of, to make films. So these films were meant for the Indian diaspora as well as for the domestic audience. Actually, it was the NRI filmmakers, not the Indian filmmakers, who walked the tight line between fulfilling the Indian diaspora wishes of having Indian films as well as the domestic audience need for good cinema. So the central themes were issues and stories pertaining to Indians. So even though it was talking, if some film was talking about NRIs, it was only talking about NRIs then. Then it was not talking about the West in general. So the problems and that NRIs faced. So important filmmakers are Meera Nair, Deepa Mehta, are well known. Of course, Gurinder Chadha is also one of the names that I would like to mention here. So let's talk about Deepa Mehta. She is an Indo-Canadian filmmaker based in Toronto. And she is famous for her Elements trilogy, which consists of Fire, 1996, Earth and Water. So these were films about the Indian society. Even though she lives in Toronto, she made films about India in India. So Fire, of course, is a relationship between, it's a homosexual relationship that develops between two sister-in-laws, and which was very controversial in 1996. Then Earth, 1998 Earth, is about partition of India, and it talks about stories revolving around the partition. Water is about widows and how they are treated in Indian society. So it's all about the Indian society and the psyche of Indians, but it is made by an NRI, non-resident Indian. Then the next name that comes to mind is Meera Nair. She is an Indian-American filmmaker based in New York. She made films like Salaam Bombay, which was one of the first her first internationally acclaimed film. It's a beautiful film that you should all watch. Then you had NRI films like Mississippi Masala, which starred Denzel Washington in 1991 and Sarita Chaudhary. And it talks about NRI issues, how an NRI is dealing with being in a foreign country. Then you have Monsoon Wedding, and another film that is based in India about Indian relationships and how Indian families. And the Monsoon Wedding is a very good critique of the so-called family entertainers of the 1990s. If you look at Monsoon Wedding, you will know what I'm talking about. It's a beautiful film then that you should watch. Then of course, Namesake, about an NRI who is torn between India and the West. So these are very good films that you should all watch. Salaam Bombay, Monsoon Wedding and Mississippi Masala. So in summary, we learnt about liberalization, what is liberalization, and we talked about how it impacted Indian cinema, how television came, and how that the coming of television actually spurred the Indian cinema out of the lethargy that it was in the 1980s and made more creative cinema. Then that creative cinema was targeted for a global market. So the Indian filmmakers like Karan Johar, Yash Chopra, Aditya Chopra started making films not for Indians but for NRIs, and the NRIs in these places started making films for the Indians. So there was a sense of dichotomy. So the India actually became a more globalized cinema. India became a more regularized cinema. So there was a constant back and forth between the NRIs and the Indian filmmaker. In the next lesson, we'll talk about the impact on the production of Indian cinema. What liberalization impacted, how liberalization impacted the production of Indian cinema. Then the narrative changes because there was a change in production, there was a change in the monetary situation, how it actually narrative changes happened in Indian cinema. And lastly, we'll talk about how the single screen theaters began to fall and the multiplex culture started to rise and how it impacted the film production scenario. Thank you.